truck something that I've been wanting to for some time. I've been studying now for a long time on the book of Revelation. And I want to start a series of lessons on the book of Revelation. And I hope it'll be a blessing to you, because it really has. I was trying to, over the years, I was thinking about the many people that have come up to me and said they wish that they could understand the book of Revelation. It was a mystery to them. And studied it and finding out the symbols and everything, it has to do with the Revelation. If you understand them, you understand numbers, you understand everything that God uses in the book of Revelation, it unlocks great truths to you. And so this morning I'd like to read, if you would please, beginning in Revelation chapter 1, just a few verses, and beginning in verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bear record of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is, which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before the throne, his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, ending, saith the Lord, which is, and was, and which is to come, the Almighty. I, John, also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, and to Pergamos, and to Thyatira, and to Sardis, and to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks, and in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like in the fire, fine brass, as if they had burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand upon me, saying to me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Write the things which thou hast seen. I got several commentaries and looked behind them and read behind them. And you got to be very careful, though, sometimes who you listen to and who you read behind. But if you would, please, I'd just like to go over something before I get into it. Verse 1 says, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Galatians 1:12 says, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation means the revelation which Jesus Christ makes, not that which he reveals. John is the writer. Jesus Christ is the author of the book. Revelation means the unveiling of divine mysteries. Jesus Christ is both the mystery and the revealer of it. He comes to reveal himself, and in himself, the Father, whose image he is. In other words, Jesus came in this world to reveal the Father, which is Jesus Christ himself. He's the image of the Father. So in the opening words, the book takes us beyond itself. What is revealed is not secrets about the future, but about a person. And the revealer is not man, but God. Not John, but God's Son, commissioned by the Father. Now let's go back, please, to Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. If you notice the word in this verse, signified, it means signs and illustrations. Now you go back to the beginning, Genesis 1 verse 1, in the beginning God. Now notice, now after that everything concerning man, period, after that everything concerning man comes or happens to man. First, God created man. Secondly, God gave man a wife. Now, in the beginning, Genesis 1, verse 1, God. After the beginning, after God, then man comes into view. Then God gives man a wife. In the beginning, man was without sin. Genesis 1, 27. So God created man in his own image. Male and female created he them. Now, the question that always arises, why did God create man? Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13 and 14. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So we find in Ecclesiastes here that God made men, and he said, come to the conclusion of it for one purpose, fear God and to keep his commandments. And keep in mind that God said, I will bring everything you do into judgment. But Adam sinned, and God cast him out of the Garden of Eden and from his presence. Then sin, rampant on the earth, ran rampant upon her until God said enough. And God sent the flood and covered the whole earth with water and death, except one man and his family. Because Noah believed God. That's the only reason that Noah was saved. Noah built the ark at God's instruction. And whosoever was in that ark was saved, for they did not die in the flood. Eight people only were saved. Now, out of those eight people were the earth repopulated. Yet Noah got drunk and caused a curse to be placed upon his son Ham. But Noah had three sons, Japheth, Ham, and Shem. From Japheth came the Asian Minor, or the European people. Ham came the African Arabian people. From Shem came the Assyrian people. And they were scattered over the earth by God to show to them their appointed place on earth. Out of the bloodline of Shem, the lineage of Christ comes. Then Abraham was born, and he believed God, and it was counted unto his righteousness. In other words, what made Abraham different than all other people on the face of the earth was he believed God. And God counted that as righteousness. Out of Abraham came his son Isaac. Out of Isaac came Jacob, his son. And God changed his name from Jacob to Israel. And God made an everlasting covenant with Israel. I will be your God forever. And Israel had 12 sons. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, Joseph, Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. And out of these 12 sons, God chose Judah for the lineage of Christ to continue to come from. These 12 sons of Israel went down into Egypt for lack of food and lived there for 430 years in bondage. Then God raised up a deliverer named Moses to lead his people to the promised land. But because of their unbelief, God caused the children of Israel to wander in the wilderness for another 40 years in the wilderness. But Moses died without entering into the promised land. Yet God chose Joshua to lead his people into Canaan land. Then Israel demanded an earthly king to rule over them rather than God. Then they chose King Saul, which failed God. Then Saul died, and David became king, because he was the apple of God's eye. From David came Solomon, and King Solomon built the temple of Jerusalem. But because Solomon sinned against God and became an idol worshiper in his old age, Solomon's two sons rebelled against King Solomon and divided the kingdom into two kingdoms. The son of Jeroboam became the kingdom of Israel. The son of Rehoboam became the kingdom of Judah. And the descendants or bloodline of Christ continued in the lineage of Judah. The kingdom of Judah had 19 kings and one queen that ruled over them for the next 400 years. Then ended the sinning and rebellion against God. They ended up sinning and rebelling against God, and God gave them over to the Babylonian captivity for 70 years. The descendants of Jacob and Israel were first called Jews after the Babylonian captivity. Now, during the captivity, King Cyrus of Babylon gave a decree to restore Jerusalem and its temple, and the Jews began to return to Jerusalem and rebuild the temple of God. The Jews had three prophets in those days, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. And they led the children of Judah during those years. But after these three prophets, God is silent, and his word is silent for 400 years, unto the rise of the Grecian Empire and the Persian Empire, followed by the Roman Empire. During the Roman Empire rule, Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Then follows the ministry of Jesus Christ upon this earth. His baptism, his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, his betrayal and arrest, his crucifixion, his resurrection, his ascension back to heaven. After the earthly ministry of Christ, the Holy Spirit descends at Pentecost, and the church is born. Now, this is the church age that we're living in today, the day of God's grace. The book of Acts told us in Acts chapter 2, verses 15 to 21, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's both Jew and Gentile. That's the day that we're living in today. today we're living in the last days, just before the rapture of the church, according to 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 through 18. Now, after the rapture of the church begins the tribulation period. 7 years of the wrath of God being poured out upon Satan and all those who do not worship God's Christ and Savior of the whole world, John 3:16. Now, that's what the book of Revelation is writing for. Warning, get ready before it's too late. The whole book of Revelation has to do one thing. Going back to Noah's day, God told Noah to build an ark, and it was a warning to the rest of the world, all the world, the wrath of God is coming. Now, it's the same thing the world we're living in today. We're to do one thing today, and the book of Revelation is written for this one thing. It's a warning. The wrath of God is coming. Now, he didn't tell us exactly when it's coming, but he said it's coming. So we know it's coming. Now, the book of Revelation begins in verse 1 and verse 20. Look at it. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden sticks, candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So there's no mystery what this is then, because he plainly tells us this has to do with the churches. It's simply in the church age that we're living in. The mystery of the seven stars, which are they saw in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Now, you might not understand that this verse, but you can plainly see that number seven is used many times in this verse. Now, what I want you to see to begin with, that numbers are very important in the Word of God. Now, take the book of Revelation is a symbolical book. And then numbers is symbolical way. And the number seven is a very key word in understanding the book of the Revelation. Count. Now, notice making numbers count. I want to take numbers in these headings. Look at the science of the numbers. Look at the symbolism of the numbers. Look at the significance of numbers. Now, first of all, I want you to notice the science of numbers. First of all, God really wrote two books. He wrote the book we call the Bible. But secondly, he also wrote the book of nature. In reality, all this world is like one great big book that reveals God. I laugh at people that say, I didn't have a chance to know God. Oh, yes, you did. You know God by his book, or you know God by nature. There's nothing that God ever created. He created an animal. He created trees. He created the birds. He created the things around us. And we can plainly see by the book of nature, no man has a right to ever stand before God then and say, I didn't know that there was a greater than I am that made all these things. Now, in reality then, all this world is like one great big book that reveals God. God says this world, this universe, speaks of God. Now, as you look at the book of nature, you'll find numbers written all the way through nature. Why is this? Because God is a God of order, and God is a God of design, and God is a God of balance and proportion, and God is a God of mathematical precision. That's the reason that all the astronomers study the heavens. They find that the heavens are run by a mathematical law. That's why they can study the heavens and make their charts and turn their charts back and tell exactly where those heavenly bodies were and will be at any given time. It's like I talked to a professor. professor one time at the University of South Florida and I asked him, do you believe in God? No. He said, I don't believe there is a God. And I said, that's strange. Do you believe in mathematics? He said, yes. I said, how did the astronauts then shoot a rocket to the moon? He said, by mathematics. I said, how did that happen? He said, because you can know that it's going to be in a certain place at the exact time God has it going, and you can figure it out. It's going to be there, and how much power you got to hit it exactly that part. I said, isn't that strange? Who holds it in the place? Who holds it right there all the time? Right where it ought to be. He said, well, I got to admit there got to be a greater than any man on this earth. I said, yep, that's my God. And so that's why you study the heavens and you know that these earthly bodies was there before, it's going to be there tomorrow, and it'll be there next week. Why? Because of mathematical equations. Now, the same is true of chemistry. Chemistry is not just putting chemicals together, but it's putting them together in certain numbers or equations. The same is true in biology. If you study flowers, you'll find they all have a certain number of petals, and everything done in the realm of biology is done mathematically. It's the same in zoology. Here again, everything is done mathematically. For instance, in every human body, there are trillions of cells, and in those cells are chromosomes. And the number of chromosomes in a human body is 46. And the other number, manner of life, in the other manner of life, has different numbers of chromosomes, and it never varies. God is a God who built numbers and mathematics into the universe. Now, there is the science of numbers. There's the scientists do not make the laws. They just simply discover the laws and use the laws. Man does not create mathematics. He simply uses math. Math is created by God himself. Astronomy said long ago, number is a principle of all things. Now, when we get into numbers, you'll find out something. The children of Israel wandered in the wilderness 40 years. You find God created the heaven and the earth in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested in the eighth day, you begin all over again. These numbers mean a great deal when you study the book of Revelation. Numbers mean everything. Now, leave the science of numbers and none of the symbolism of numbers. And notice now, because to God and to those who penned down the Bible, numbers were more than a science. They had a spiritual and a different kind of meaning. And if you study numbers in the Bible, you can see just one more confirmation that the Bible is the inspired Word of God. So we'll start with the number one and see what number one means in the Bible. Notice the revelation of Jesus Christ now. And then he said he's going to show himself to the church. Because as we get into the church age in a few minutes, you'll see that the book of Revelation has to do one thing. He's showing it to the church, okay, himself. So what is the symbolical meaning of the number one? It is the number of unity and primary. Therefore, it speaks to us of God. For instance, Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Also Zechariah 14:9. And the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day shall there be one Lord and his name one. Now the reason that's so important is simply this. There's not a bunch of gods. Now you get over in the book of Romans and you'll find that the early Christians and those that was coming in hearing them preach, they began to have other gods more than one. And Paul come back to them and said, there's only one God. And so when we understand the number one, God makes it very plain throughout the Bible, there's one God. Now, Ephesians chapter 4, turn there with me for just a minute. Ephesians chapter 4. And I want you to let's begin to read in verse 4. Ephesians 4 and verse 4. There's one body, one spirit, even as you are called into one hope for your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Now notice, so the number one in the Bible stands for God, for primary, for unity. Everything is summed up in the one great God. We do not worship three gods. Also, he is three in one. But we worship one God, the one and only God. He has revealed to us himself in these three persons, but he is one God. Now, what is the symbolic meaning of the number two? Two in the Bible stands for witness. It speaks of confirmation and witness. For instance, John 8, verse 17. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. You never come under the law of Moses. You never came by one and accused somebody of something. You had to have two, because two is the number of witness. Now, John 8, verse 17 says, it is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. So, that in two is the number of witness and confirmation. It is a business meaning. For instance, someone makes the motion, another seconds that motion, that confirmation is witnessed by two. Even the Bible that gives witness of our Lord is divided by two, the Old Testament and the New Testament. Who is the second person of the Trinity? The Lord Jesus Christ. Notice what Jesus is called here in the book of the Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 5. Now look at verse 5. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own body. So, when it comes to Jesus being the witness, notice the faithful witness. So, two is the number of witness. Jesus is the faithful witness. Now, remember now, when Jesus was raised from the dead, two angels were at his tomb to give witness of his resurrection. When Jesus ascended up to heaven, two angels were there to give witness to his ascension. Now notice how these things work in the book of the Revelation. Turn over to Revelation chapter 11 with me now. Revelation chapter 11, verse 3 and 4. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. They are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. Now, notice something. Here we find that there are two special persons on the earth during the tribulation that are going to witness during this time. So number two is the number of witness. And when Jesus sent the 70 out to witness, how did he send them out? According to John, two by two. And by the way, you can't find a better way to witness for the Lord Jesus Christ than to go with a partner to go witness for the Lord Jesus. Go by two by two. So find your witness partner if you're going to witness somebody about their salvation. Then notice the number three. Three is all called a divine number. It speaks of the Holy Trinity. One is a number that speaks of the unity of God. Three is a number that speaks of the triunity of God. For instance, when we baptize people, we baptize them in a triunity formula. Matthew 28, verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. So that's the triunity. Why baptize this way? Because this one God has revealed himself to us in three persons. Three is the number of Trinity. Isaiah 6, verse 3. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Now, why three holies here? Because God the Father is holy, God the Son is holy, God the Holy Spirit is holy. So you see, God is a triune person. The Bible says man is created in the image of God. And the image or likeness of God is moral, mental, and physical. But there's another way in which man is also in the image of God, and that is reflected in that man is triune. Man is spirit, soul, and body. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 23. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad that 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 23 is there? My spirit's not just going to heaven, and not just my soul is going to heaven, but I'm going to have my body in heaven. Why? Because God said I saved all three of them. Amen? Man made in the image of God is also made in the triune nature then. Everything that God has made reflects the triunity of God. If you take the entire universe, you can sum it up in two words, time and space. And time is triune, past, present, and future. Space, height, width, and depth. And all is the same, and one cannot exist without the other. And so God made the universe, God made man, God made us all to reflect his triunity. And three in the Bible is symbolical of our Lord and his triunity, a triune person. Number four, what does four stand for? Four stands for God's creation. Four is the number of the earth, the world number, the creation number, the earth number. Isaiah 11 and verse 12. This is the four points of the compass. Ezekiel 7, 2. Four is the earth number. Revelation 7, 1. Here comes out of the book of the Revelation. Revelation 20, verse 8. Notice how the number four is linked to the earth. All of these numbers, if you take those verses, now if you go back to Revelation chapter 4 and look at verse 6 with me. Revelation chapter 4 and verse 6. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, gold and white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. Now, when we read here four beasts, again, if you continue on, you'll find these four beasts in just a minute, you'll see it. One's like a lion, one like a cat, one like a man, one like an eagle. Four being, now remember this, four being the number of creation, then we understand that those four beasts really mean then all creation will praise the Lord in heaven. And as you study the history of the world, there has been only four world empires, starting with the Babylonian Empire, and ending with the Roman Empire. And we see then that four is the earthly number. And God not only has these things written into astronomy, but God has them written in history. We can start, if you understand anything, you start putting numbers together. For example, 4 times 10 is 40. And you will get to the number in just a little bit, but I want you to watch this. 10, again, we'll get to. But multiples of 4 deal with earthly testing and earthly trials. Now, it's very important you understand this. If you understand numbers in the book of Revelation, and we'll get to where these numbers are put together, then you understand that they're talking about earthly testing and earthly trials. If you live on this earth, you're going to be tested, and you're going to have trials. For example, It rained on the earth when Noah was in the ark 40 days and 40 nights. Have you ever wondered why God said it rained, it only rained 39 or maybe 41? Because the number 40 in the Bible is talking about testing and trials. When Jonah came to preach to Nineveh, Nineveh had 40 days and Nineveh would be destroyed. Jesus was in the wilderness being tried of the devil and tested 40 days by the devil. So 40, the number of testing, which is a multiple of 4. Then you come to the number 5. 5 and 10 basically are the same. We used to call it 5 and 10 cent stores. Now 5 symbolizes completeness. 5 fingers. I used to have more fun when I'd go be with a mother that had a baby. You know, a brand new baby in the hospital. I said, oh, look, got 6 toes. And man, that what am I sure that it shocked them, you know? And 6 fingers. Now, get this, because it's very important when you understand the book of Revelation. 5 fingers, 5 toes, 5 senses. So 5 written in nature and in God's word means fullness are complete. And it's the same with 10, which is just the double of 5. 10 fingers, 10 toes. Again, it means completeness. For instance, when God gave his complete moral law to the children of Israel, how many commandments were there? 10. You don't add to them, you don't take from them. 10. Notice now, this is used in the Revelation. Notice how it's used. Go with me to Revelation chapter 13. And I want you to look with me in verse 1. Revelation 13, verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy. Here's a beast, or a picture of the Antichrist. Notice he has 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, as you study the Revelation, you'll find out that not only are the numbers used symbolically, but other things also. For instance, a horn in the Bible prophecy is a symbol of power. Now, here's a beast who have 10 horns, Revelation 13, verse 1. And if 10 is a number of completeness, this speaks of complete power. So during the tribulation period, the great tribulation period, the Antichrist is going to have complete power upon this earth. So the beast, the Antichrist, will completely rule the world in those last days. Now number 6. The number 6 is a symbol of man. Revelation 13, verse 5 through 18. And you'll come to the word, the letter 666. These numbers are starting to come together. Remember now, what is a triunity of number? Triunity number 3. And here is 3 sixes. 6 is the number of a man. Keep that in mind now. 6 is the number of man. 3 is the number of deity. So what is this picture of? Here is a man pretending to be God. 3 sixes. And in the morning you'll see the 7 is a perfect number. And we know man is no 7, he's a 6. So the 3 sixes stands for perfect imperfection. Now the number 7, the perfect number. Why do we call the number 7 the perfect number? Simply because 7 is 3 plus 4. Now what's the importance of that? 3 is a divine number. And 4 is an earthly number. When God, heaven, and earth get together, then things start to working out as they are supposed to. This is earth crowned with heaven. God rested on the 7th day. 7 days are 1 week. God built into the musical scale 7 notes. The 8th is but a repetition of the 1st. So 7 is a perfect number. Now that helps us to understand things in the Revelation. For instance, go back now to Revelation chapter 3 and verse 1 again. Verse 1. And to the angel of the church of Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and of the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Now, 3 is the divine number, 4 is the earthly number. That would be blasphemy then. John, be careful if God had 7 spirits. But John doesn't mean 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 Holy Spirits. John means the perfect Holy Spirit. So when we understand how God is using these numbers, it makes a whole lot more sense to us. And here God is using the number 7 in a symbolic way. Another one is Revelation chapter 5. Look at verse 6. Revelation chapter 5, verse 6. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb that had been slain, having 7 horns, and 7 eyes, which are the 7 spirits of God sent forth unto all the earth. Now, notice, remember the beast in Revelation 13, verse 1, had complete power. But here, Jesus has perfect power. 7. 7 horns. Remember what horns are in the Bible, they're power. 7 eyes. The 7 horns speaks of power. Speaks of Jesus' power. 7 eyes speak of his perfect illumination. He sees everything. He knows everything. You cannot hide from this one. He has perfect power. And the number 7 here used means perfect, and we can find it many times in the biblical history. For instance, Joshua marched around Jericho 7 days. And on the 7th day, he marched around Jericho 7 times, and the wall came tumbling down. And God gives us the parables in Matthew 13 and the kingdom of heaven. How many parables are there? 7. In Revelation 2 and 3, there are messages of the 7 churches. And these are 7 lampsticks, lampstands, and 7 candlesticks. Israel's symbol today is 7 branch candlestick. There's on each side and a center stand. 3 on each side equals 6, the number man. 1 in the middle, that's God. And God plus man is the light of the world. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. So here are 7 churches who have the perfect light of God. God and man let the light of the world shine. In other words, God doesn't speak out of heaven no more. He speaks through man to you and I. God uses man to reveal himself to us. Now, as you have seen, as we went through these numbers, there are multiple 7 in Scripture also. Jesus sent 70 out into his message to witness as he sent them 2 by 2. In the book of Daniel, Daniel gives all the world's history from the time of the revelation of the throne of Christ in 70 weeks, Daniel chapter 9. And in each of these weeks were weeks of years. So there's 70 times 7 years equal 490 years. Simon Peter asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive someone? Jesus told him, 70 times 7. Peter knows 7 was a perfect number. But Jesus said 70 times 7 are perfect forgiveness. No matter how many times we need it, then Jesus will forgive. That's what he's talking about. Did you know that Jesus is the only one that can perfectly forgive you? Now notice, this whole book of Revelation is in multiples of 7. 7's all the way through it. Because it's earth crowned with heaven. And when 7 is cut in half, that speaks danger. That speaks disaster. That speaks despair. Elijah shut up the heavens that it rained not 3.5 years. That was judgment of God upon the earth. Antichrist will make a covenant with Israel for 7 years for peace, but in the middle of the 7 years, he's going to break that covenant, according to Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, Daniel 9, 27. 3.5 years is half of 7. Revelation 13, verse 5, 40 plus 2 months, 3.5 years. So anytime you see the number 3.5 in Scripture, that means look out, because there's doom or disaster ahead. Now, what should the number 8 mean? What does 8 speak of? 8 in the Bible is the number of new things, new beginnings. And it tells us symbolical of the new birth that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. There are 7 notes in the musical scale, but an octave is 8. That 8th note is that new beginning of that new octave. And it speaks of a beginning again. Now, do you know what the 8th day is? It's the first day of the week. The Sabbath is the 7th day. Sunday is the 8th day. Now, what does Sunday speak of? It speaks of the resurrection. It speaks of the first day of the week, which is really the 8th day of the week. In the Old Testament, a child was circumcised on the 8th day. Why was he circumcised on the 8th day? There was a physical reason, but there was a scientific reason. But there was also a symbolical reason. Because that Old Testament circumcision was a type of our salvation. Colossians 2, verse 11. It speaks of the new life in Christ. And when Noah came into the ark, notice what God did with Noah after the flood, 2 Peter 2, verse 5. And spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the 8th person. Speaking of the new world, a preacher of righteousness. 8 souls were saved by water. So you see, the church of Christ speaks. People would have you to believe that these people were saved by the water of baptism. But 8 speaks of salvation. It speaks of the new day. It speaks of the new birth. And salvation and a new birth is of the Lord, not water. Remember this, Jesus was in the grave 3 days. Do you know why God, the day came out, what day Jesus came out of the grave? It was the 8th day. Jesus arose on Sunday. Saturday is the 7th. Sunday is the 8th. And by the way, Jesus appeared to his disciples 8 days later, according to John 20 and verse 26. After 8 days, again, his disciples were within and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, "Peace be unto you." Again, Jesus was transfigured before his disciples, and that transfiguration was a prophecy and a picture of the second coming of Christ. And Jesus was transfigured on the 8th day. 8 is therefore the number of new beginnings, new things. 8 speaks of new birth. Now, from here we'll go into the number 12, and I'll start again with that, if you would please. But what I'm trying to show you, as you study the book of Revelation, it is not a mysterious book if you understand how God uses symbols and types and figures to explain something. And remember now, he's not talking to the world, he's talking to his church. Because we'll show you in a few minutes, as you begin to study, the 7 churches. And these 7 churches represents the churches of all the ages. And so this book is a tremendous book.